Leading up to Valentine's Day, Paul Solman takes an encore look at the economics of dating, how some people are using market principles to overcome the traditional impediments to finding the perfect match. It's an updated presentation of our Making Sense series, which airs every Thursday.
Facebook software engineer Mike O'Byrne, aka Seriously Online, had been looking for a date since moving to New York 4 months earlier.
It was really my brother's urgings who told me I needed to start going out and dating people.
Ad agency art director Priyanka Pulijal, also new to New York. Her love handle was BRB Eating Cupcake. The BRB is web speak for Be Right Back.
I think you have to meet a lot of different people to first understand what you want. And I think once you understand what you want, you have a lot of different options.
So what did they want? Each other?
Hi. Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
Last February, they agreed to let us record their very first date.
Do you guys mind leaving now?
Okay, we would BRB. But while we gave our daters some alone time, we checked in with their online matchmaker, OkCupid. Founded a decade ago by four Harvard math majors, the site was owned by IAC, the same media conglomerate that ran Match.com, which charges a monthly fee, and the mobile app Tinder.
Between OkCupid, Tinder, Match, we'll sign up easily over 30 million people this year alone.
That was OkCupid co-founder Christian Rutter. 9 months before IAC spun off the dating websites, selling stock in them to the public via an IPO. There was already plenty of competition, though. eHarmony was big, and niche sites were trending for Jews, Christians, farmers, sea captains, mimes, the gluten-free, the incarcerated, the unhappily married, and of course, accompanied by Mozart.
Welcome to personals.com. As a fellow cat owner, I know how finicky we are.
But no matter how finicky, you're better off with more than less.
Imagine a mixer with three people. That would be a pretty rough hour if you lasted even that long there. OkCupid, metaphorically speaking, is a mixer with 4 million people.
In the language of economics, the study of maximizing human welfare, this is what's known as a thick market.
Where would you rather buy a pair of pants? At the Mall of America or on the streets of a small town in Oklahoma?
Economist Paul Oyer has actually written a book. Everything I ever needed to know about economics, I learned from online dating, based on his own adventures looking for love.
So I found myself back on the dating market in the fall of 2010, and immediately, as an economist, I saw that this was a market like so many others.
Well, not any old market, like the one for pants. This is a market for what economists call differentiated goods.
No two potential life partners are the same. Every single one of them is different. From an economics perspective, searching for a partner is just cost-benefit analysis. This isn't funny. This is economics.
And that analysis includes, in the lingo of economics, search costs.
It takes time and effort to find your mate. You have to set up your dating profile. You have to go on a lot of dates that don't go anywhere. These frictions, the time spent looking for a mate, lead to loneliness, or as I like to say, romantic unemployment.
Oyer found himself romantically unemployed when he first took the online dating plunge, as it happens on OkCupid, and had written separated on his profile. But at least he didn't say he was actually unemployed or drug happy or a glutton, even bigger turnoffs. Those are among the tidbits gleaned from the millions of responses in OkCupid's database, shared by Christian Rutter in his book Dataclism. Not that all are exactly shockers.
When people come to a dating site, all they look at is the pictures for the most part.
Rutter has since left OkCupid, but beneath the sidewalks of New York, Erica Christensen is still hawking what is arguably a more discriminating approach.
You're very handsome.
Single by any chance? Do you find yourself single? A matchmaker.
Yes, a real live matchmaker whose turf happens to be the subway.
You're very handsome.
The days leading up to Valentine's Day are the busiest of the year for this Hello Dolly of the L train, who was looking for lasting love on behalf of two 30-something female professionals.
What we're dealing with is the biological clock, and these women want the 35 to 45 year old man quick. They want him yesterday.
So you mean that you're sizing up these guys as
potential baby daddies? That's right.
Since time is money, clients are willing to pay a couple of grand or more, sometimes much more. Okay, Cupid, by contrast, is free. But to Christensen, you get what you pay for.
I think online dating is great, but it's basically humans as commodities.
There's another objection to online dating as well.
Okay, Cupid, by making a huge universe of people available to you at any minute, doesn't that work against a rational decision about whether to invest in the relationship you have?
Writer R.D. Rosen, who's used online dating, is working on a book about middle-aged courtship.
There's an enormously addictive quality to online dating that has never existed before in the culture. You want to keep going back because you think you're going to hit the jackpot eventually.
Rutter doesn't deny it.
And whether you're gay or straight, we're constantly showing you people. There might be someone better looking or who has a cooler profile or whatever it is just right around the corner always.
And not just gay or straight.
At OkCupid, we have 22 genders and 13 orientations.
That's right, 22 genders and 13 orientations, including our favorite, sapiosexual, attracted to intelligence. And to further complicate, Chief Product Officer Jimena Almendares has just added another option.
Earlier this year, we launched that feature that if people are searching for someone else in their relationship, they can actually publicly state that, and people that are interested can respond.
To Paul Oyer, though, a surfeit of choice is just another search cost, for which economists have a fairly simple solution.
What you need to do is you need to settle, to say, I have somebody who's good enough. People hate it when we say that, but it's the way a rational economist would think about it.
But wait a minute. After my first date with my now wife, I knew she was the perfect mate, and last year was our 30th anniversary.
The perfect one for you does not exist. But there's a very important idea in labor economics called firm-specific human capital. And that is, as you work at a company for a longer time, you have certain skills that are valuable at that company and not elsewhere. Well, you've built up something we'll call marriage-specific human capital. You've developed your life around your wife such that she probably is the best match for you at this point.
Meanwhile, our daters had to get back to their jobs. So how had it gone?
So we both found out that we had like way more in common than we expected.
I felt we really connected about a lot of different things.
I'll probably email her later.
Actually, he didn't. That same week, he met a new flame. Meanwhile, Priyanka began dating an old friend. A year later, they're still going strong. As for me, Paul Solman, economics correspondent for the PBS NewsHour, I'm still ever so happily married and wishing all of you, online and off, another welfare-maximizing Valentine's Day.